capital.com.
Only one more Friday after today until the voting ends. So let's review where this economy stands, shall we? From American Public Media, this is Marketplace.
Marketplace is supported by Progressive Insurance, offering a way to buy home insurance with their Home Quote Explorer tool. Custom quotes and rates are available online. Learn more at progressive.com or 1-800-PROGRESSIVE. Now that's Progressive. And by Avalara, simplifying sales tax compliance with cloud-based solutions. Avalara automatically integrates with more than 700 of the most widely used ERP and e-commerce solutions. Avalara, tax compliance done right.
In Los Angeles, I'm Kai Rizdahl. Friday today, the 23rd day of October. Good as always to have you along, everybody. It sounds simple, I know, but it's kind of not. Sussing out where things stand 11 days out from when this election is going to end. But that is the job, so we will do it. Gina Smilek's at the New York Times. Kate Davidson is at the Wall Street Journal. Hey, you two.
Hi, Kai.
Hey, Kai.
So, Gina, let me start with you and the first question, which I think is the easy one. Big picture. Where does this economy stand right now?
The economy is recovering, but it is absolutely not through the wilderness yet. You know, we've seen unemployment come down really sharply. It's down to 7.9% as of September, which is, you know, it was at nearly 15% back in April. So that's pretty solid and rapid recovery. But that said, 7.9% is still very high unemployment. We've still got, you know, millions and millions of people out of work who had jobs as recently as February. And there's still a lot of progress left to be made, getting those people back to work, helping them make up for the income that they've lost over this period, and making sure that they can sort of get back to regular economic life to the extent possible.
Kate, we are going to get a report next Thursday, the first look at third quarter gross domestic product. It's going to be a big bounce off a really bad bottom, and there will be much made of it. Frame that for me, would you, in terms of where this economy stands?
Well, Republicans, you know, will be very excited. They'll be talking about how positive this report is, how it demonstrates that the economy is really bouncing back. As you said, though, it's coming off of this low, so it's going to be important. We'll hear a lot of economists saying you need to look at the level, not the rate. So, well, we'll see this huge percentage increase. As Gina mentioned, the level of GDP is still way below where we were before the pandemic. There are still millions of people out of work, so it's important to think about it in that context. And I think it's also important to remember that we have more recent signs that some of that momentum that we had over the summer has stalled. You know, getting the initial sort of waves of people back to the jobs, you know, the employment gains we've seen so far, the way to think about those are sort of the easy pickings, if you will. You know, there was sort of an easy big bounce when businesses that had been completely shut down started to reopen. But I think it will take much longer from here on out to see more improvement.
Gina, I don't want to get too weedy, but you wrote this week about the Federal Reserve and how some of the programs that the Fed initially powered up with Treasury backing behind it, and let me repeat, we don't need to get too weedy here, it kind of hasn't panned out. And I need you to explain what's going on with that.
Right. So I think of this as sort of a two-part story. So part one is the good news part of the story, which is that the Fed came out and said, hey, look, guys, we have $454 billion to back these programs. Any kind of market chaos you throw at us, we can deal with it. And just having that sort of confident statement and all of that money behind them allowed them to really convince markets that things were going to be okay, provided a backstop, allowed markets to calm down. And so they never really had to employ that money just because the private sector took care of itself once it was confident that the Fed was ready to step in. Part two of the story is a little bit less optimistic, which is that the Fed had promised to try and set up these facilities that would lend money to mid-sized businesses and get money to municipalities. The municipality program has worked to some degree as a backstop, but it hasn't made a lot of what I think you can essentially think of as loans. And the mid-sized business program hasn't been used very much at all. And so for various design reasons, those programs have fallen a little bit flat. And so I think that's the less happy part of the story is, you know, the Fed tried to stretch into areas where it hasn't really tread before, and it didn't always work out super well.
Okay, so we had the Fed with its lending programs, Kate. I want to pick up on something you reported on this week, and we did some work on this week as well, and that is fiscal stimulus, relief from Congress and the White House, and how it is not coming, and how that imperils the way this recovery is going to look. Explain that.
Sure. So I think one way to think about it, which is what we tried to do, is comparing it to the last economic downturn. You know, what happened after the 2008 crisis? Within a couple of years, Congress had done a bunch of stimulus, but then the Tea Party came in and people were worried about all the spending and deficits, and they pulled back. They sort of shifted to austerity. They tightened belts, the federal government and cities and states. And what that essentially did, we know this, over time, there's been a lot of research. We can look at the numbers. That was a drag on economic growth, and it ultimately slowed down the recovery. We had a very long expansion, the longest in history, but it was pretty weak. It was not that strong. And so, policymakers are really worried about making the same mistakes this time. So they're concerned that the longer the economy goes without more fiscal support, most economists think the economy needs some more fiscal support, some more economic relief. The longer it goes, the harder it's going to be to stave off some of these traditional recessionary forces. So more layoffs, falling incomes, a pullback in lending, lower demand, things just start to get really hard to counteract the longer the economy goes in this weak state. And that just can lead to a really uneven and long, slow, painful recovery.
Which is, it has to be said, kind of what we're looking at now, given the way those negotiations are going. Gina, I am loath to dip too much into the debate last night, but anything in half a minute or so that economically struck you out of that debate?
You know, I think one of the interesting things that I think came up again and again in the debate is that so much of what happens next in the American economy actually hinges not necessarily on any specific economic policy, but rather on the pandemic response. Mm-hmm. I think that President Trump clearly is portraying himself as the better option for the economy because he's not going to close it all down again, because he doesn't want to do that, and because, you know, that'll allow us to keep going. I think Vice President Biden has clearly made it a real talking point that, you know, the reason we had to close down so drastically in the first place is that we didn't get this under control. And so I think, you know, we've got control on one hand, lockdown, no lockdowns on the other, and voters are going to have to make a choice there.
Kate, 30 seconds, super quick, last word to you. Anything you want to point out from last night?
No, I think that Gina's right. I thought, Kai, you were going to ask me about the stimulus, so I had a zinger for you, which is, if I may. This is my world right now. I can't stop thinking about this. And really, I thought a colleague put it perfectly this week. He said, it's like when you're on the phone, there's really not much more to say, but nobody wants to hang up. I think that's kind of where things are. So if you were sitting there thinking, well, it sounds like Washington's going to come together and we'll have some stimulus soon, I don't know about that. I wouldn't hold my breath.
No, you hang up first.
Yes.
Oh, my goodness. Gina Smilek at the New York Times, Kate Davidson at the Wall Street Journal. Thanks, you two.
Thank you.
Hang up first. All right. Anyway, we got to go. More sideways than up or down on Wall Street today. Banking, they were, says a banker buddy of mine, that the relief bill is going to get done, no matter what Kate Davidson's friend says. Color me dubious. We'll have the details when we do the numbers. We did a story yesterday, maybe it was Wednesday, I don't know, I lose track, about how a lot of us who are working from home are going to be working from home a lot longer. And while you maybe don't need office attire as much anymore, you got to wear something, which is, as we like to say on this program, a business opportunity. Case in point, Zara, the Spanish fast fashion retailer, just announced a new lingerie collection, which might be better described as stuff you'd wear to lounge around the house. Loose-fitting cotton pajama pants and silk button-down shirts. And Kohl's says it's going to be launching an athleisure brand come the springtime. Evidence, as Marketplace's Marielle Segarra reports, that retailers think casual is here to stay.
At the beginning of the pandemic, Dina Gashman was not exactly wearing her Sunday best. She has a toddler. He was out of school. She was trying to work.
Like, I probably had a robe on half the day and my hair was just a complete mess. And then I started to think, okay, it's going to make me feel better and it's going to be better for my sanity if I maybe put some mascara on or put on an actual outfit.
Eventually, Gashman, who lives in Austin, Texas, even bought some new clothes.
I got one pair of pants from Target that are very soft, comfortable cargo type pants that I could probably sleep in, but then I could also wear with heels.
I'm sorry, heels? What are those again? But that right there, that is the sweet spot retailers are aiming for. Clothes that are comfortable, but don't make you feel like you've completely let yourself go. Bronwyn Cosgrave, who hosts the fashion podcast A Different Tweed, says there's a particular consumer these retailers are targeting.
A woman who did get dressed up to go to the office and doesn't want to lose that aspect.
And Cosgrave says buying lingerie and athleisure is becoming a form of retail therapy for many women.
It is an affordable luxury. It's an impulse buy that's not going to dent one's mortgage payments or car payments.
In recessions past, women bought lipstick instead. But, you know, lipstick and masks, not the best combination. I'm Marielle Segarra for Marketplace.
Two things before we go on. Number one, the Marketplace Morning Report. Check it out. Come Monday morning, set you up for the economic week ahead. Number two, if you miss this program on the radio, a lot of people don't know this, actually. We've got a podcast. Check it out. Hollywood has been basically forever less diverse than the population as a whole. Whiter and more male on camera and behind. Over the past couple of years, the industry has faced some pressure to change to reflect the audiences that studios need. And a new report from UCLA looked at nearly 1,000 broadcast, cable, and streaming shows to measure how much progress has actually been made. Here's Marketplace's Jasmine Garst.
The report is called A Tale of Two Hollywoods because while women and minorities made gains in nearly every category of employment in television, top executive positions are still dominated by white men. Fewer than a third of studio chairs and CEOs are women, just 8% are people of color. The greatest racial and gender disparities are in behind-the-camera jobs like director, showrunner, and writer.
I know I told you I didn't care, but I do. And I still have feelings for you.
That's Issa Rae starring in Insecure, the HBO show she created. It features a mostly black team of writers and directors. But in TV, fewer than a quarter of writers are people of color, and only 22% of episodes were directed by people of color. Darnell Hunt, dean of social sciences at UCLA, says this no longer makes business sense.
The mainstream market itself is diverse. And if you have executives who are largely white men making all the decisions about what gets made, you're going to have more misses than hits.
So what's it going to take to change? Deborah Zimmerman of the nonprofit Women Make Movies, which supports independent film and television, says it'll take the same thing it always does in Hollywood.
They have always made decisions about money. And the Hollywood studios and the television networks are concerned with the bottom line. And what they just need to realize is that diversity in gender and race really pays.
She says the numbers are encouraging, but there's a long road ahead. I'm Jasmine Garst for Marketplace.
Coming up,
I'll definitely take a break with some great turkey leftovers.
Pandemic or not, the turkeys are coming. But first, let's do the numbers. Dow Industrial's down 28 today, about a 10%, 28,335. The Nasdaq found 42 points, about 0.3%, 11,548. S&P 500 picked up 11 points, also 0.3%, ended at 34.65. The virus is the economy, as we say on this program. So, a check on the numbers, shall we? The U.S. reported more than 71,000 new coronavirus cases yesterday, highest since July. The CDC says cases are growing pretty much all over the country, calling this, and this is a quote, a distressing trend. We heard from Marielle about the casual clothing trend. A couple of apparel retailers here. Kohl's added 3.7%, Gap up 1.2%. You're listening to Marketplace.
Marketplace is supported by C3.ai. C3.ai software enables organizations to use artificial intelligence at enterprise scale, solving previously unsolvable business problems. Learn more at C3.ai. And by X-Chair, maker of the X2 home office chair with dynamic variable lumbar support and 10 ergonomic features to fit users of different shapes and sizes at xchair.com or 8444-X-Chair. And by Mimecast, offering cloud email security, Mimecast is dedicated to protecting companies from spam, phishing, and other email-based cyber threats. Serving more than 20,000 Microsoft 365 customers, Mimecast.com. Relentless protection, resilient world.
Did you know that you can support WLIW-FM with corporate sponsorship opportunities? Broadcasting live from studios in Southampton, 88.3 WLIW-FM reaches a listening audience throughout the Hamptons, the North Fork, and coastal Connecticut, plus across the New York region and the country. Streaming online at wliw.org/radio. For information about corporate sponsorships on Long Island's only NPR station, call 631-591-7020.
When starting a business, it helps to do your research.
The New York Small Business Library was game-changing for me.
Nancy Twine developed her hair care company one step at a time, and while Slow and Steady won the race for Briogeo.
In politics, races are won, in part, with money, carefully spent on advertising. That's coming up on the next Planet Money.
And How I Built This from NPR.
Sunday afternoon at 1. On 88.3 WLIW-FM.
I'm Kai Rizdahl. You're listening to 88.3 WLIW-FM and WLIW.org/radio, Long Island's only NPR station. This is Marketplace. I'm Kai Rizdahl. A dip into the markets-based capitalism tea leaves now with an eye to the calendar. Analysts and economists have long looked for patterns linking presidencies and stock markets. Who's better for them? Who's worse? Even what might markets be able to tell us about elections and presidencies? Turns out there are some patterns. Marketplace's Sabri Benishour takes a look at what the record shows.
There's data on the stock market and presidencies going all the way back to 1789, and Jurrien Timmer has dug through it. He's director of global macro at Fidelity Investment. Here's how things tend to go.
The first 2 years of a four-year term tend to produce below average results for the markets.
7 to 8%, he says, over 2 years.
Whereas the last 2 years produce above average returns, around 9%.
This is on average, mind you. It is not a rule. Yale Hirsch, author of the Stock Trader's Almanac, first came up with this presidential election cycle theory in 1968. Investors are still talking about it. Jeffrey Green is a writer and former finance executive. He says there's kind of a folklore as to why the markets tend to move this way.
As the incumbent gets into years 3 and 4, they're now focused on re-election. So the idea is to pump the economy.
And therefore, the market goes up. Green says this is probably way overinflating the power of a president over the economy. He says the Federal Reserve has a lot more influence than any president. Tiffany LaHer is a financial advisor with Rogers Associates. She's not a fan of presidential election cycle theory or other theories that pretend to crack the mystery of the market.
I wouldn't plan my strategy for retirement based on any of these theories that are out there.
Presidential election cycle theory has not held up very well in the past few administrations. And in any case, it's based on averages over more than a century. And if 2020 has taught us anything, it is that we have absolutely no idea what is next. In New York, I'm Sabri Benishour for Marketplace.
You don't want to touch stuff right now if you don't have to. You don't want to have to pick up a menu or fill out some registration form or something. You're just not feeling that. I get it. Good thing there is technology then, huh? Those little black and white patterned squares you scan with a smartphone, quick response codes, they're called, QR codes. They are having kind of a moment in this pandemic. Nicolas Rivero is a tech reporter at Quartz. He has been writing about their rise these days. Nico, thanks for coming on.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Super quick as we get going here, a lot of people are familiar with barcodes, right, from long, long ago. QR codes are sort of the next evolution. What makes them different? What makes them better?
So the whole magic of a QR code is that it stores information in two dimensions, right? So if you think of a barcode, it's a series of one-dimensional lines, and it can only store so much information that way. because QR codes are these little patterns of squares, they can store a lot more information, something like a web page's URL, which is why you can scan them and go to a link.
Okay, so hold that thought for when we get to the what they're being used for now, but I do want a little bit of history out of you first. 10 years ago, plus or minus, QR codes kind of come on the scene in a big-ish way, but as you say in this piece, they were just terrible.
Yeah, there were three big problems with QR codes when they first kind of came out to consumers back in 2010. So the first is, if you wanted to actually scan one of these things, you had to download a separate bespoke app to be able to do it. The second was cellular data at the time wasn't as good as it is now, so it wasn't a sure thing that you'd be able to actually load the web page you were looking for when you're out and about, which is where you'd come across these QR codes. The third thing is just that no one could actually figure out a good use for them. So a lot of brands came out with QR codes in their advertising because they wanted to position themselves as tech savvy, but they would just do it in ways that didn't make any sense. Like you'd have, for example, a Subway ad with a QR code on it that the only way you could get up close enough to actually scan the thing would be to stand directly on the subway tracks.
Right. Okay. So now here we are, 2020. More data's out there floating around. Technology is better. Smartphones mostly can read them pretty easily. How are they being used now?
So the use that people probably have seen most often is that as restaurants have reopened, they've used QR codes to replace handing you physical menus. One of the more interesting uses, I think, is that PayPal and Venmo have rolled out QR codes for mobile payments in the U.S., which is something that's been very popular in China. And there's one more thing as well, which is that there are contact tracing apps which are using QR codes to be able to kind of give people a way to show that they have tested negative for coronavirus before entering a building.
Right. And you could see that being sort of the passport thing, right? You get that code, you show it on an airline or whatever, and in theory, you're good to go, right?
Right. That's like another big use in China. And we're slowly seeing maybe some rollout of that in the U.S. Abbott, that company that's selling 150 million rapid COVID tests to the federal government, has an app for that. You take the test. It gives you a QR code. A company can scan it and say, okay, you're good to come in.
Let me just throw in a really quick cautionary tale here. I'm sure it's like 80% of the American population has a smartphone. But that leaves 20% of people, which is millions of people who don't. So that's one issue. And then another one is, if you're like, and she's listening to this, I'm going to hear about this later, but if you're my mom and somebody says, no, I'm sorry, you need to do a QR code, mom's, you know, she tries, but she's not the most technologically savvy person in the world. What do you do for them?
Well, that's exactly right. So this is definitely, as you said, a big point of caution and something that I think is giving people pause about rolling out QR codes too widely, especially for pandemic uses, like determining whether you can board public transportation or enter a building or something like that.
Right. And one would hope there would be some workarounds for the non-technologically savvy amongst us. Nico Rivero, he's a technology reporter at Quartz, talking to QR codes. Nico, thanks a lot. I appreciate your time.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thanksgiving is a holiday of superlatives. It's one of, if not the, biggest travel weeks of the year. There are big family gatherings, and then, of course, the big meal, usually centered around a big turkey. But about that last part, the bird. As Marketplace's Kristen Schwab reports, even in this year when those big lots-of-people feasts aren't such a great idea, the turkey industry is trying to convince us that even in a pandemic, you can go big and stay home.
John Peterson's family has been in the turkey business for 80 years. And right now, there are thousands and thousands of turkeys roaming around his farm in Cannon Falls, Minnesota.
These turkeys are all hens. They're all female turkeys. And by the time that we get to Thanksgiving, they'll be right around 18 pounds or so.
18 pounds is usually the sweet spot, but not this year. Grocery stores want smaller birds and more of them for the smaller gatherings we're supposed to be having. Problem is, turkey farming is a science. The birds are engineered to reach Thanksgiving size at Thanksgiving. And Peterson can't just flip a switch and change that.
We're working with nature. We only have so much control over their rate of growth. And when their hatch date was determined a year in advance, a lot of that cake was baked before we had the chance to change it.
So Peterson is slaughtering some of his birds early at around 12 pounds, but that comes at a cost. He's had to rent extra freezer space to store them. Plus, he's really a free-range, fresh turkey farmer. Those birds go for about 40 cents more per pound. And selling any birds at a lower weight means there are fewer pounds to sell altogether. Which is exactly why the industry is trying to keep the demand for big birds alive by marketing the idea that cooks will be blessed, not stuck, with the leftovers. Beth Breeding is with the National Turkey Federation.
If anyone's like me, I've been cooking more than I'd like to over the past few months, so I'll definitely take a break with some great turkey leftovers.
Like turkey eggs benedict, turkey tandoori kebabs. The organization is even pushing Korean turkey dumplings. Not sure my ancestors would approve of that one. And if you're not a fan of turkey for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, there are alternatives to the big bird. Kyle Locke is Senior Director of Retail Marketing at Butterball, which may explain why his Zoom screen name is Meat Marketer.
You know, we have shifted a more emphasis towards other products. We have ready-to-roast cook-in-bag products. We have boneless turkey roasts, which are smaller, like 3 pounds. It also helps people who are just like, boy, I'm a little bit nervous about how do you attack this whole thing.
And there are expected to be a lot more first-timers in the kitchen this year.
The centerpiece of this thing has to be right? I mean, we got to land this jump.
Or get an assist from the secret chefs who've been helping with dinner behind the scenes since the pandemic began. Meal kit makers like Blue Apron, HelloFresh, and Home Chef are also trying to elbow their way to the table with Thanksgiving boxes. Even so, Minnesota farmer John Peterson is still banking on families going the traditional route.
Maybe we're just trying to delude ourselves, but I do think there are lots of reasons to think that now more than ever, people are craving tradition. So we're optimistic that people aren't going to be, you know, eating ham sandwiches with their green bean casserole on Thanksgiving.
In the end, it all comes down to who will be stuck with the leftovers, the turkey industry or us. I'm Kristen Schwab for Marketplace.
This final note on the way out today, in which your electronic privacy is going to have a rough 2021, I'm sorry to have to tell you. A report from Forrester Research, they do market research, it says email, text, and other forms of what are known as push notifications, because basically they push them out to you. Anyway, that's going to go up 40% next year. They're all about customer loyalty and retention by any means possible. Companies are, of course, even as the pandemic heats up and consumers get more skittish.
Marketplace is supported by Indigo Ag, believing that investing in agriculture as a nature-based climate solution is an investment in the health of people and planet. IndigoAg.com/carbon support. And by TIAA, who knows clients' passion will never run out, nor will TIAA's commitment not only to get clients to retirement, but through it. More at TIAA.org/neverrunout.
All right, I went a minute long in the wrap, so we just got to get out of here. Our theme music was composed by BJ Lederman. Marketplace's executive producer is Nancy Fargali. Nancy Cassid is the managing director of news. I'm Kai Rizdal. We will see you Monday, everybody. Have yourselves a great weekend, would you? This is APM.